Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private and whether to consider in private at future meetings a draft report on the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill. Are members agreed? Thank you. Our second item today is consideration of two affirmative instruments. The first instrument is the Alcohol Minimum Pricing Scotland Act 2012 Continuation Order 2024. The purpose of the order is to continue the effect of minimum unit pricing provisions which were inserted into the Licensing Scotland Act 2005 via the Alcohol Minimum Pricing Scotland Act 2012. In the absence of this order, those provisions would expire. The policy notes that minimum unit pricing has had a positive impact on tackling alcohol-related harms in Scotland and should be continued, as evidence suggests that if MUP was no longer in effect, then alcohol consumption would increase, contrary to the policy aim of reducing alcohol-related harm. The second instrument is the Alcohol Minimum Price Per Unit Scotland Amendment Order 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to increase the minimum unit price, currently set at 50 pence per unit, to 65 pence per unit. The policy note states that evidence has found MUP at 50 pence per unit has had a positive impact on health outcomes in Scotland, and that in order to derive greater health benefits, the current level should be raised to 65 pence per unit. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered these instruments at its meeting on the 27th of February 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to these instruments. We will now have an evidence session with the Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy and supporting officials on both of these instruments. And once we have had our questions answered, we will proceed to a formal debate on both motions. And a welcome to the committee, Christina McKelvey, Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy, Orlando Heimer-Mason, Drugs Policy Division, Catherine Myatt, Health and Social Care Analysis, and James Wilson, Population Health Strategy and Improvement, all from the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. I'm pleased to be in front of you today to discuss minimum unit pricing and the two draft orders that were laid on the 19th of February. The Alcohol Minimum Price in Scotland Act 2012 Continuation Order 2024 seeks to continue the effect of the minimum unit pricing provisions beyond the initial six-year period. The Alcohol Minimum Price per Unit Scotland Amendment Order 2024 seeks to change the level from 50 pence per unit to 65 pence per unit. Scotland is facing a burden of disease in the next 20 years, a growing burden of disease. Non-communicable diseases are the leading cause of death and ill health in Scotland, and alcohol is one of the key contributors to this. Members of the committee will know that in September 2023, the Scottish Government published its report on the effect of minimum unit pricing in the first 5 years of operation. This report drew heavily on the studies included in Public Health Scotland's comprehensive evaluation of the policy, an evaluation commended by internationally renowned public health experts, including Professor Sir Michael Marmont and Professor Sally Caswell. During this study period, the Public Health Scotland evaluation estimated that minimum unit pricing reduced alcohol attributable deaths by 13.4%, 156 people a year, and was likely to have reduced hospital admissions wholly attributable to alcohol by 4.1% compared to what would have happened if minimum unit pricing had not been in place. Alongside consideration of the impact of minimum unit pricing, the Scottish Government also undertook a review of the price per unit. The decision to lay regulations that would increase the price to 65 pence per unit is underpinned by the modelling carried out by the Sheffield University. Their research suggests that to maintain the value of the price per unit and therefore to continue to achieve the public health benefits at a level estimated by Public Health Scotland evaluation, it should be increased to at least 60 pence. However, it is clear that Scotland continues to experience significant levels of alcohol harm. The Scottish Government is therefore proposing to increase the value of the price per unit to 65 pence to further increase the public health benefits of our policy. I expect, and Sheffield University's modelling predicts, that if this increase is implemented, it will save additional lives. I know that some don't agree on minimum unit pricing, but we have considered their concerns in reaching this position. Many business stakeholders told us during roundtables held in 2023 that implementing any price change quickly may be difficult. This was echoed by the Regulatory Review Group. They recommended a six-month implementation period would be necessary to allow business to prepare for a price increase. I am pleased to say that we have listened, and should Parliament agree to increase the minimum unit price, this will be implemented from the 30th of September 2024. I am clear that minimum unit pricing is a vital part of the Scottish Government's approach to tackling alcohol-related harm. However, it is not a silver bullet. No single intervention in issues such as complex as alcohol harm would be. For some findings in the Public Health Scotland evaluation, it was clear that some people who were alcohol dependent had experienced additional challenges linked to the price of alcohol increasing. I know that specialist support and treatment is vital for these people. To this end, the Scottish Government has provided a record funding of £112 million this year for Scotland's alcohol and drug partnerships. This funding supports the critical delivery of services for those affected by alcohol dependency, including outreach, psychosocial counselling, inpatient and community alcohol detox, access to medication, alcohol brief interventions, alcohol hospital liaison and alcohol-related cognitive testing. In addition, residential rehabilitation offers programmes which aim to support individuals to attain an alcohol or drug-free lifestyle. Public Health Scotland's most recent interim report, published in December last year, showed that of the 386 ADP-approved residential rehab placements, almost half, 48%, were for people with problematic alcohol use, and 20% were for people with both alcohol and drug issues. In 2023-24, the Government also provided £13 million in funding through CORA to support a range of projects to help those with substance addiction issues, including alcohol dependency, into treatment and recovery. Minimum unit pricing is an important part of our approach to reduce alcohol harm and improve the health and well-being of our population. The decision to continue minimum unit pricing and to increase the price per unit to 65p will show that Scotland continues to be world-leading with our policies to improve the health of people in Scotland, a position recently supported by over 80 third sector organisations, senior clinicians and leading public health academics from Scotland, UK and further afield. Convener, I look forward to discussing this further with you this morning, and I welcome questions from you and your colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that opening statement, which actually preempts what was going to be my first question. So I'll move on. So you touched on some of the claims from certain stakeholders, that conclusions that Public Health Scotland had reached in its evaluation of MOP were, and I'm quoting here, selective, biased, misleading or flawed. How would you counter that and how would you respond to those claims?
So I think, as I said, not everybody agrees with minimum unit pricing, convener, but I think the evaluation from Public Health Scotland and the work that we have done and those 80 organisations and frontline organisations tell a very different story. And if you look at the letter that was sent from a leading number of public health officials to the Lancet, which is a letter including Professor Michael Marmon and Sally Caswell, and they're saying the concentration of the decrease in mortality in the lowest income groups is particularly welcome, and as a narrowing of health inequalities was one of the key intentions of the policy, and this has been achieved. Now, I know that some people don't agree with minimum unit pricing, but I have to say that the professional judgment and the experience of frontline organisations and people with lived and living experience tell a very different story. They see the value of minimum unit pricing and they support its continuation and its uprating.
Thank you for that. And I should place on record my register of interest. I'm a registered mental health nurse with a current contract, a bank contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. Can I just ask briefly about the initial aims of MUP was to decrease the sales of high alcohol ABV, high alcohol per volume products. particularly strong ciders, etc. Has the government done any research into the sales of those products and if it's had an impact on them?
So I met with the industry partnership group last week to have a discussion about further proposals and working together on this. I'm very committed to working with the industry on this, but some of the analysis that we have seen, particularly around about the academic analysis and Public Health Scotland analysis, is some of those more high potent, very cheap ciders and other alcohol like that, there's been a definitive drop in the use of those, and particularly amongst young people. We're seeing young people under the age of 25, and the health study for young people, health and wellbeing study that's done in schools, a survey that's done, tells us that young people are declining quite quickly in numbers of who would access that type of high alcohol, cheap price at the time of minimum unit pricing's original debates. It was called pocket money. Alcohol, it's not that now, and if there's any impact on the industry at all, it's on the cider producers in Scotland. They're seeing a real decline on the sales of those types of alcohols.
And in terms of other products, I'm thinking here things like whiskey, spirits, have you seen an impact in the sales of those products?
So there doesn't seem to be, the analysis that we've done, there doesn't seem to be any impact on alcohol because it was already sitting well in excess of 65 pence anyway, and that's in the off-trade. In the on-trade, it sits about £2.04 pence in average per unit. So the off-trade, we've not really seen any impact there at all because it wasn't. That's not where the policy was targeted at. It was at those high alcohol, low prices products that were available. So we've not seen that impact on those at all.
Thank you, Minister. Tess White has a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. Public Health Scotland evaluation of MUP is riddled with holes, and as are the conclusions drawn by the Scottish Government on MUP's effectiveness, and that's not my view. The Law Society said, and I quote, "In our view, the study does not provide enough evidence that the introduction of MUP saves lives," and other stakeholders in the Scottish Government's consultation have described the evaluation as flawed, selective, biased and misleading. So how does this square in your opinion with the robust evaluation that former Health Secretary Nicola Sturgeon promised during the bill's parliamentary passage in 2012 ahead of the sunset clause expiring? Thank you.
So I wouldn't agree with that characterisation of the evaluation. The Scottish Government tasked Public Health Scotland to undertake an independent evaluation of minimum unit pricing. There was two overarching evaluation questions. One was, to what extent has implementing minimum unit price in Scotland contributed to reducing alcohol-related health and social harms? First question. The second one, are some people and businesses more affected positively or negatively than others? And the evaluation plan for minimum unit pricing contains a portfolio of studies which are either undertaken by Public Health Scotland, commissioned by Public Health Scotland to external research bodies, and through open procurement processes separately funded and led by academic partners. So there was a whole slew of information taken into account on this, and Public Health Scotland took a theory-based approach to that evaluation of minimum unit pricing, its implementation and compliance, its alcohol market, alcohol consumption and alcohol harm. And the outcomes of the Public Health Scotland evaluation is that it is estimated to have cut alcohol consumption, cut alcohol attributable deaths, and likely to have reduced hospital admissions wholly or attributable wholly due to alcohol during the study. The minimum unit pricing evaluation also told us that it reduced health inequalities, where we've seen the biggest reductions in men and those people living in the 40% areas where there's the highest inequality. I would argue that Public Health Scotland took a robust approach to this. There is people out there who don't agree with this policy and will have a different opinion, and that's absolutely fine. My opinion is based on the work that Public Health Scotland have done and the work that Sheffield University have done for us, and of course all of the organisations who are working on the front line, including those with lived and living experience, who have seen the benefit of minimum unit pricing over the last few years.
And Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. And just a declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. Good morning, Minister. You said you were talking about underage drinkers just there. Could you point me to the evidence that shows MUP has reduced underage drinking, please?
So the impact on underage drinking has been pretty marked, and something that we should look in more detail to. And it surely demonstrates the benefit of doing that health and wellbeing survey with children at school, because that's where some of this data has come from. So the health behaviour in school-aged children survey, all these things have got big long names, showed that levels of drunkenness in school-aged children at 15 years had steadily declined, and it's now at its lowest number for 32 years. Some of that has been picked up by Curriculum for Excellence in the school, and some is with specific projects. So I was along
specifically saying that MUP has led to a decrease in underage drinking. That was the question, Minister.
So the Public Health Scotland evaluation did not find that. It didn't go into that detail, but the health behaviour survey in schools did. So that gave us some of that additional information about young people. And some of the actions were taken through Curriculum for Excellence in the Health and Wellbeing strand of that work, and also work that organisations are doing within schools now. So just recently I was along at Craig Royston High School, who had worked very closely with Crime Stoppers and their youth wing of that's called Fearless, to look at ways in which young people could seek advice and get support should they be them or their friends embarking on hazardous drinking habits, and the same with drug habits as well. So that's allowed children to get that support that they need at that age, and they're taking
sure
it up.
That's the case, Minister, but the quote that you did here was about underage drinking, and Public Health Scotland have said they have found no evidence that MUP has reduced underage drinking. Is that correct?
Public Health Scotland have said that, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister, for the opening statement. I'm interested in some of the other measurements we might look at around MUP, and I think probably we've seen strong evidence and reported back about the health harms and the evidence around how it affects industry. But I just wondered if you had any views, or if you've saw any evidence around some of the other indicators, you know, both positive and negative, in terms of, you know, does it help to reduce crime, reduce, you know, maybe other social harms? Is there any evidence to suggest that people have moved to other addictive substances? So it was just to see whether you felt there was a need for more evidence in that area, or if there is some stuff that you could point us to.
So there's a couple of things there. The Public Health Scotland analysis showed us that the biggest impact was on men and people in that 40% category of having the highest inequality, which is a piece of work I think we should interrogate further. I think that's where I'll go with that. The other thing is the impact on women. So we've seen very different impacts on women, because women generally drink things that are above the 65 pence or the 50 pence per unit already. So we need to maybe do a bit more work around about women. But anecdotally, what I was hearing when I visited the Craig Miller Project last week was many, many organisations like the Bothy and Craig Miller, who deal with drugs and alcohol, they've set up women's groups to look at the particular barriers that are faced by women. And one of those barriers is stigma. So the work that Professor Alan Miller's doing on with the National Collaborative on a rights-based approach to this is looking at some of those intersections. And those intersections are sometimes the deepest when they are overlapped with other things. So there's areas that we are working on, in particular thinking about women and thinking about what I'm hearing anecdotally, but we need the evidence to back that up. And I know that the analysis have got a much deeper detailed understanding here.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that to say that the Public Health Scotland evaluation, as the Minister said, it took a theory-based approach. And one of the things that it did was to look at any potential unintended consequences of minimum unit pricing. So that included what you mentioned there, you know, the impact of minimum unit pricing on crime, road traffic accidents, switching to higher strength alcohol or illicit substances. And it did find that there wasn't really any consistent evidence of minimum unit pricing having impacted upon these things, with the exception of some negative impacts upon dependent drinkers, and particularly dependent drinkers on a low income, showing that they have perhaps in some occasions switched, they'd maybe not been able to buy food because of the increase in price in alcohol, but these were a few occasions and quite difficult to attribute to MUP.
Yeah. And the thing about dependent drinkers is that they were never the focus for this policy. It was always the harmful and hazardous category. As I said in my open remarks, that category of people need a much more nuanced, detailed approach, and some of the work that we're doing around about treatment and how to access treatment has been pretty successful there. But again, you know, still worth looking at. And Carol, did you ask me about drug use as well? People maybe changing to...
Yeah. It just that there had been some suggestion that might happen, but I think, you know, there's some evidence.
I think the frontline organisations to support people had that worry, but it's not materialised, and they've been pretty open. I think they've said it in evidence to this committee in the last few weeks that they've not seen that, and I think we've not seen, Public Health Scotland found no evidence that people started to use drugs because of the increased price in alcohol, and that's in that harmful hazardous group. As I say, dependent drinkers is a very different approach being taken to that work.
So I suppose, if just one wee question, just to be clear, you know, obviously, because as an important policy we're going to be voting on, the government are confident that it worked in the area that it should have worked in, but there is some commitment there to look at some of the evidence around it and any work that we need to do in that other area.
So we're not committing to a huge Public Health Scotland review like the one we've just done, but I am committed to reviewing much of the areas where we feel that needs a bit more focus. So that's why I'm focusing in on dependent drinkers and women and some of the other challenges that other people have had around about this. So I think, you know, the commitment is to keep this under review, essentially. And the work of this committee on this is incredibly helpful for that, you know, to inform the work that we are doing, but also to challenge us and where we should be looking as well. And I welcome that.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Ivan McKee.
Yeah, just a very brief supplementary. Good morning, Minister. Team. Going back to the conversation with the question from Ms. Sandesh Kulhani, with regard to underage drinkers and the effect of MUP, I think I absolutely agree anecdotally, there certainly does seem to be a lot less alcohol consumption amongst young people these days in that group. But of course, we do have the opportunity to come, you know, whether that's due to MUP or other factors, I can understand that we might not know that. But is there any work been done to analyse whether the difference in Scotland is significantly different to trends we're seeing in the rest of the UK with regard to the reduction in consumption of alcohol amongst young people? Because that might point to policy choices here making more of an impact. I think that would be interesting data if that's available.
Yeah, we've done some analysis of that sort of across border and comparison analysis of what's happening here compared to other parts of not just the whole of England, but England and Wales and other parts of England. So you may have seen the letter, I think, came to committee from the Association of Directors of Public Health in North East England and their analysis on this. There's always work that we can continue to do on this area. And what we haven't really realised, I think, is the impact of COVID. I think we've still got a bit of work to do on what the impact of COVID is, and that will play out as we move forward. I think in Scotland, what we are seeing is that group of under 25s who, I mean, I've got a son who won't even put processed food in his body, never mind alcohol, and I know lots of families that are like that. That doesn't mean to say we're not taking the focus off where there's problematic and harmful drinking going on in younger age groups, and that's why that health and wellbeing study of 15-year-olds is incredibly important, because that gives us real-time information and data and how we then can target that. And that's why organisations like Crime Stoppers and Give It and others are working in schools now, because I think that education part of it is incredibly important.
Right, so just to be clear, I'm assuming there is data available on alcohol consumption rates, Scotland versus the rest of the UK, and what does that show for young people?
The health behaviour in school-aged children survey is it's a multi-country survey, so we can compare Scotland with other countries. Those trends are observed in other countries. I'm not sure of the extent to which Scotland is showing a greater decline than other countries, and it's not something that, as the Minister has said, it's not something we attribute to minimum unit pricing. There are other interventions and other things happening in schools which...
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here this morning. I'm interested in how the pandemic impacted alcohol consumption. I know I've got a wee brief in front of me here from Alcohol Focus Scotland that talks about, 156 lives being saved, 499 hospital admissions per year on average that have been averted. But I'm interested in how the pandemic affected alcohol consumption, and did it impact on the data that was being measured by Public Health Scotland?
So Public Health Scotland took information from a range of measures. Some of those studies, I think maybe 7 or 8, included the COVID years type of analysis, so we can get you more detail on that via Public Health Scotland on some of the deep analysis on that. But I think, is it the blog that you're talking about that was written?
I
spotted that as well when I was spotting it over the weekend. I spotted this coming through on the airwaves and had a good look at it as well. And although we realise that there was an increase of harmful drinking across COVID, we've still not been in the position yet of completely analysing that and understanding what that means and what it means for recovery going forward. That has included, an uptick in people suggesting that they have had an increase in their drinking habits, mostly in the people who were in the harmful, hazardous, who are now looking for ways in order to reduce that as well. So it's an area where we need to keep working on, because I don't think we are anywhere near understanding the impact of COVID on many things, never mind, people's habits. Social isolation and loneliness, for instance, is a driver for people looking for ways to escape social isolation and loneliness, and some people would become more alcohol dependent in those areas, and we treat social isolation and loneliness as a public health issue now. We're treating this as a public health emergency now and looking at the data that's coming through on that. But about 8 of the studies had info that included the COVID years, and we can get you much more detailed analysis on that, unless Catherine, who has been much embedded in all of this work, will be able to pick that up.
I think there's 2 parts to your question. The first one is, what is the impact on COVID on people's drinking habits and what might we expect for the future? And the other one is about whether COVID impacted upon the evaluation. So just to reiterate what the Minister has said about drinking habits during COVID, it is still early days and data takes a while to come through, so we don't fully understand the impacts on that. But the data we do have show that consumption did change during the pandemic and that it became a little bit more polarised, with people who were already drinking a lot drinking even more and people who did not drink a lot drinking even less. As part of the price review work that Sheffield University did for us on the modelling, they looked at what might happen over the next 20 years with health harms caused by these changes in drinking patterns. And even in the most optimistic scenario, even if drinking patterns go right back to pre-pandemic levels, which we don't know yet if that's what's going to happen, even in that scenario, they expect that there will be increased health harms caused by the pandemic and the drinking during that time. So I think that gives us further impetus to do more work in this area. On the second part of your question, on whether the pandemic impacted upon the evaluation and the ability to properly evaluate minimum unit pricing, the Public Health Scotland adjusted for COVID where it impacted. So as the Minister said, only 8 of the 40 papers actually included data collecting during the pandemic. And the method that Public Health Scotland used in a lot of their studies was to compare Scotland with England, and obviously the pandemic was also happening in England, so that acted as a sort of control for that. So we are confident that COVID didn't, you know, interfere with the ability of the evaluation to determine the impact of MUP.
Thanks.
And we'll move to Paul Sweeney, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks to the panel. Just wanted to ask a question around some of the discussion in the 2018 study. There was a business regulatory impact assessment on price elasticity of demand, which found that alcohol generally is quite an inelastic product. So as price increases, consumer behaviour won't really change very much. And that basically means that there's a rent created which flows to the retailer or the vendor of the product at the expense of the consumer. There was some observations of where the price does become more elastic, such as off-trade cider. And I think we've seen some of the evidence around those particularly potent ciders reducing in popularity as a result of minimum unit pricing. It didn't seem that the most recent study by Public Health Scotland addressed some of the analysis around price elasticity of demand. I wonder if the Minister or some of our colleagues might be able to narrate perhaps what they have found in that regard. I know the Sheffield model did find that heavier drinkers were more responsive to price change, but nonetheless, people who have an alcohol dependence are more likely to continue to consume alcohol, but will find themselves perhaps in a more financially distressed position as a result.
No, smashing question. Thank you so much. Mr. Sweeney, I think in the committee will be keen to know that we have published an up-to-date BRIA, which goes into some depth. I was only about 3 days in the job when these lovely officials presented me with a 70-page document to work my way through. So that goes into some detail there, and we're happy to make that available to the committee as we go. Mr. Sweeney's right that some of the elasticity in prices has really impacted on those high alcohol, low-priced products. The cider market will tell you that their market has collapsed in Scotland, although we would probably argue that not too much. But that has been where some of the biggest impact of MUP has been noticed from a business point of view. I think we take the approach of the World Health Organization about accessibility and availability and how you tackle that. And price and setting a minimum price is one of the tools that the World Health Organization suggests we use. So that, along with the work of Public Health Scotland and Sheffield and our commitment to ongoing review, we will keep this under review, because I think we want to make sure that we're being responsive as possible. And the work that was done on analysing what price point it should be set at, you know, the price point that many thought, and Sheffield I think thought, was about 62 pence, tying in with inflation and all of the issues, we felt that 65 pence would be the level in which it would create the circumstances to drive down again some of those sales and drive down hazardous and harmful drinking. So we're taking into account all of these things, including the World Health Organization's recommendations around this.
That's helpful. Just also wondered if there have been any reports back from the on-trade on potential, and it was observed in the Sheffield model that there was an elasticity observed in spirits being traded on the on-trade in bars relative to beer. I just wondered if that had been some feedback that may have perhaps come from industry, that they'd observed a change in consumer behaviour in the on-trade.
So I think you've stumped me there, Mr. Sweeney. I don't have that information either in my head, I think, or in this folder about that comparison between spirits and beer. But we can certainly look at the analysis that's been done and provide the committee with an update on that. If it exists, we'll get it to you.
That's helpful. Just also noted, certainly in the 2018 study, the estimated impact of 50 pence minimum unit pricing on consumer spending. And it did highlight that, on average, for the consumer, there is a small impact, particularly if they're moderate drinkers, but the largest impact is on those who are most likely to buy the products liable to be affected. So basically those on low incomes who drink at harmful levels. and that the dynamic of the minute unit pricing is to transfer that wealth, if you like, from or the income from the individual consumer who's maybe a problematic substance user, problematic drinker, in perhaps poverty, to a retailer. Has there been an effort from the government to look at those that particular segment of the consumer and to sort of look at ways to mitigate that, whether it's through money advice or targeted interventions to try and mitigate the impacts on their household income?
Yeah, and the BRIA's got some of that additional detail in it around about industry and the impact on industry, but I think you hit the nail on the head about the reason why we're doing this, and this again is only one tool. Minimum unit price is only one tool. It's for that impact on people, not just on minimum unit pricing, but then the cost of living crisis is an impact on everyone. So there is additional work, additional support given to ADP, so that sort of a record funding of £112 million this year, and the commitment that we've made over the next this whole term of Parliament, so for the next 2 years, of £250 million. Contained within that is all of those supports. So one of the ways in which we approach this is through a whole family approach, so looking at some of the challenges that people have in their life, you know, homelessness, debt, all of that. So all of that advice is all factored in with the supports on that, and that's proven incredibly supportive and helpful for people who are in the categories that Paul Sweeney's just mentioned. And if you look at the managed alcohol programme that's been undertaken in Glasgow with the Simon community, particularly with people who are homeless, we have a wonderful case study which I can make available to the committee of a particular individual who has taken part in the Simon community's pilot project of managed, who's now in a supported tenancy, has had income maximisation work done because they weren't claiming anything, didn't know they were entitled to anything, and have had all of those other social supports that they need, including being able to access other types of therapy and support that they need. That person's now become a peer mentor. So you can see the real benefit of taking that whole family or person-centred approach. And we're really interested in the outcome of the pilot of the Simon community, particularly for a very vulnerable cohort of our population who may maybe find themselves with a harmful use of alcohol, but also unemployed, homeless, and with very, very little family support. That's one aspect of that person-centred. And the other aspect of taking the whole family approach is looking at the whole family and what they're entitled to and where we can engage with them to ensure that they're getting all of that holistic support. I think we all understand that approaching one thing with one, response is never going to work in these circumstances. So it has to be that whole family approach. And that's where the third sector, the charity sector, our ADPs and all of the professionals who are working in this field become incredibly important. So we have that multi-agency approach to those individuals.
Thanks. I mean, it is important that you've highlighted those particular examples of interventions that are shown promise. Is the Minister engaged with local IGBs, integrated joint boards in health and social care partnerships, just to highlight that with potential financial pressures on them in the coming financial year, that they don't take decisions that might undermine or impact on these programmes to try and target support to people who are facing these particular problems?
Yes, most definitely. So I think I've been in this role for about 8 weeks now. What I tried to do was to maintain as much of Elena Whitman's diary as possible to maintain continuity so that the regular things were still happening with the regular people. And amongst that, trying to learn the portfolio, but also trying to engage with some of the key stakeholders. And I've done quite a lot of work over that over the past few weeks. And we've had a number of round tables and other ways of gathering evidence from stakeholders. One of the issues that's arising time and again is this worry around about IGBs. When the First Minister appointed me to this post, he said, "Your budget's protected," which I have to say is a very privileged place to be, and in any level of government right now where your budget's protected. So I've got a plan of events over the next weeks and months to discuss with IGBs and boards how that money should be spent. I'm absolutely clear that the money that's coming from my budget for ADPs and for frontline services through IJIBs and boards is to be spent on those subjects. And I'll make that clear when I meet with them. But it's a very tough circumstance for everybody right now, and I want to be, you know, as supportive as possible. But I'm absolutely clear that that money is to be spent where we have agreed it should be spent.
Conscious not to indulge the convener's patience, but I just wanted to ask, like, obviously we've seen...
Mr. Sweeney, we need to move on. Right. I've got lots of other people who are keen to ask questions, okay. And I'm going to move to Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, convener. Minister, you said that dependent drinkers were never the focus of this policy. Is that your position?
So the minimum unit pricing policy was always about hazardous and harmful drinking. We always knew that there would be a nuanced and different approach needed, and additional support needed for dependent drinkers, yes.
So when the Scottish Government was in court and Lord Ordinary was speaking, one of the things that Lord Ordinary said was, in contrast, that minimum alcohol pricing will target the really problematic drinkers to which the government's objectives were always directed. To me, that sounds like dependent drinkers.
Well, it depends how you define problematic, doesn't it? I would define problematic...
Really problematic.
Well, I would define problematic as people who are hazardous drinking too. And that's the focus of this work. If it impacts on it, the dependent drinkers as well, but... There's always been the clear understanding that that group of people being more vulnerable and more stigmatised and need a nuanced and more detailed support structure around them, and that's the work that we're doing. In addition to this, I said in my opening remarks that this is not the silver bullet. This is not the answer for everyone, but it gives some of the answers for most people, and we've developed other answers for some of those other people as well.
Certainly, when you say problematic drinkers, I would we could have a discussion about what that means. But really problematic to me, which is what is in the court findings, that goes further, doesn't it? The word really.
In the court findings.
In the court summary.
In the summary, so not the findings.
In the court summary judgment.
Yeah. So my approach is that this is to target all drinkers. But we know that dependent drinkers need a different and more nuanced supportive approach.
So, sorry, the Scottish Government's position in court was that this was to target all drinkers.
And the analysis for Public Health Scotland over the last 6 years has demonstrated to us that it's much more nuanced than that. So the approach that we are taking is to ensure that that support's
sorry,
in place.
In court, the Scottish Government's position was that this policy was to target all drinkers.
Yes.
OK. Now, when it comes to problematic drinking, when it comes to people with dependent drinking, we heard from Paul Sweeney about what has happened. They are spending more money on alcohol and often choosing to spend that money on alcohol, not to eat and not to heat their homes. We have seen a cut in Glasgow and Edinburgh for money going into drug and alcohol treatments. So how does this square with your objective to try to help?
Would you let me briefly?
Yes, please.
Could you clarify which financial year you're speaking about?
So going forwards.
Well, then we haven't seen a cut yet, but there's proposals. Mm-hmm. We discuss closely with ADPs and with Health and Social Care Partnerships about their spending plans, which are in the power of local areas to respond to local need. But the Minister has been very clear in her answer just now that the investment that goes to ADPs is earmarked for that purpose, and her expectation is very clear that it's spent on that. And she'll be able to say, I'm sure, the level of investment that's gone to ADPs is at record levels.
So we should expect to see a reversal of the proposals by Glasgow and Edinburgh?
Well, you should ask Edinburgh and Glasgow about that.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
Sorry, those are decisions for Edinburgh and Glasgow, but we're very clear in discussions with Edinburgh and Glasgow that we expect the money to be spent for those purposes for which we give them the money.
OK, so there's a proposed cut, and that's going to surely harm dependent drinkers when it comes to treatment services, when it comes to helping them, because we know MUP is causing a problem to them. So how can we ensure that dependent drinkers get the help that they need in what you said was a nuanced approach?
So can I just clarify as well, are you meaning the budget 23-24, 24-25?
Yes.
Yeah. So, and the proposed cuts, proposed cuts to ADPs?
To drug and alcohol services.
So I'm absolutely clear that the budget that we have provided for ADPs this year gets spent on ADPs. And it is at a record amount. So the money for ADPs is going up, has gone up this year. And my my direction, I think, if I have to go that far, will be that that money is spent on ADPs and the work that they have to do, including the very detailed the work they do with dependent drinkers. And that ties into Mr Sweeney's question before about in contact with IGIBs and boards and the work that they're doing, because obviously this is a shared responsibility across health and social care. But my my direction is that that money is to be spent on ADPs and the work that they do on the front line.
OK, thank you very much.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Can I go back, Minister, please, about the targeting of this intervention of minimum unit pricing? I know some people have said that this is a flagship policy, it's a silver bullet, and you've mentioned that yourself. But I'm keen to just clarify about how we support the most vulnerable people in society. And I know that the Association of Directors of Public Health in the North East, they did send us a letter, and they said that we need to be similarly proactive and enlightened in public health policies in England to reduce alcohol harm and protect the most vulnerable in our communities. So the North East England public health experts support this action that's been taken forward in Scotland, because North East England has similar alcohol harm that we were seeing in Scotland. So I'm interested to hear specifically again about how minimum unit pricing is to target a specific group, that it's not just a silver bullet for everybody.
Yeah. Yeah, it's never been a silver bullet, and it's never been in isolation the only thing that we are doing. If you look at the letter from the Association of Directors of Public Health in England, the paragraph that jumped out at me was around about positive health impacts, which have a higher proportionate impact on people who are in the deepest health inequalities. So, for instance, they said the positive health impact of the policy compared to what would have happened without MUP can be seen both in annual death statistics before the pandemic struck and when comparing the rise in alcohol deaths in Scotland and England since. In the first full year after MUP was implemented, there was a 10% reduction in alcohol-specific deaths and a small reduction in hospital admissions for liver disease. And one of the key areas of this is the high incidence of liver disease in Scotland, and how we can tackle that to reduce the harms there. It also goes on to say changing drinking habits during the pandemic combined with reduced access to services led to a tragic rise in alcohol-specific deaths. We recognise that and we are focusing on that piece of work. They then said, however, it was substantially lower than the rise experienced in England, and particularly the rise in the North East. So they analysed the difference between not having minimum unit pricing in England, in the north of England, and having it in Scotland, and have obviously come to the conclusion, their professional judgment and conclusion, that minimum unit pricing targeted those areas where the biggest inequalities were, in particular around about hospital admissions and deaths. I mean, 156, if that's somebody that's in your family, that's a precious person. So every 156 of those are continue to be precious as well. And the points I made earlier in response to the question about the impact on women and the impact on some other groups as well, that's a piece of work that I think I want to pick up and look at too.
And I forgot to remind everybody that I am a registered nurse, former liver transplant nurse, and I should remind everybody about that. Thanks.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your team. Minister, what evidence led the Scottish Government to conclude that the unit price of 65 to go above it was too high for Scotland? Because there's some out there who would argue if we increased it above 65%, 65 pence per unit, that it would increase the harm from alcohol and deaths.
Can I maybe bring Catherine in on this, because that detail around about the analysis and the decision making there was before I was in post, so I don't have the benefit of hindsight to remember that. So but Catherine was immersed in this, so she can maybe give you a much more detailed answer.
Yeah, so to come to a decision on the price and to inform that work, we commissioned University of Sheffield Alcohol Research Group to do some modelling for us. And that was to look at the impact of new price points on alcohol-related health harms and also on the industry. And what we were looking for was a balance of where we see the impact on health harms that we want to see. We see, you know, that we're saving lives, that we're reducing hospital admissions, and also that we are careful upon the impact upon industry. And that 65 pence was judged to be the right balance. That was where we were going to see increased effects compared to if we'd gone for, sorry, it gets a bit complicated here, 50 pence in 2019 would be 60 pence today due to inflation. We wanted to go a little bit further than that and see increased benefits for health. So 65 pence was judged to be that point where we saw the benefits for health and we did not interfere too much with industry.
Coming on that slightly, I mean, there's a point here which is about targeting the policy around alcohol that's cheap relative to strength. So the further up that you go, the more, you know, the clearer it is you start to bring in types of alcohol that might not reasonably defined as that. So you start to drift away from the policy intention as well. So
I have no further questions because the Minister answered them in their opening statement.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Torrance. We'll go back to Paul Sweeney for a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to ask about, obviously, we discussed earlier some of the challenges about financing public services, particularly those targeted at harm reduction in communities through integrated joint boards and so on. And obviously, we discussed the dynamics of minimum unit pricing as being basically a rent created by retailers, and that creates an extra income for those private sector retailers. That kind of that juxtaposition does jar with me, and I realise there are some policy limitations here. But is the government looking at opportunities to capture some of that revenue to bolster the public finances?
So, Mr. Sweeney, you'll know that some in the sector have asked for the Scottish Government to look at a public health levy on this, and it's something obviously we have considered in the past, and certainly in the most recent budget statement, the DFM intimated a willingness to re-look at that. I think it goes back to the response that Catherine gave to David Torrance about getting the balance right, and that's why my conversations with this business sector and the public health sector become really important about getting that balance absolutely correct in a way that, you know, I don't know if we'll ever be able to negate any negative or positive outcomes on either side of the argument, but the commitment is to review again whether a public health levy is something that we should consider. We're at the very early stages of that, because it was only announced a few weeks ago in the budget. I'd be happy to give the committee an update in future weeks and months on that work and where our intention is to be. You'll know that we consulted on marketing last year, and some of this came through in that consultation. We're committed to doing more of that work over the next year or so, and that's one of the ways in which we will consult with both the industry and the people who are working in the front line and delivering public health measures too. But happy to update the committee when we have more detail on that.
Yeah, that's a helpful indication from the Minister. Happy to rest at that point, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and morning, Minister. This is obviously the first time we've uprated MUP, and due to the length of time between it being introduced and now, some people are feeling it's quite a jump. Has government considered whether we require legislation for an automatic uprating or something similar of minimum unit pricing going forward?
So that's been raised with me already over the last few weeks, particularly when the budget statement had included within it a commitment to look again at a public health levy. So that's one thing. The other thing is on the uprating, and you'll have heard from Catherine the detailed work that went into that to set it at the level that we we think would be the most effective level. On that, some areas of the sector have asked about having an annual uprating, for instance, so I'm committed to looking at that. Again, it's an early piece of work. We've not really developed much further than making that commitment right now, but I think it's a piece of work that will be valuable to do. And if there's a sort of annual uprating, or you know, that you know we can set into legislation at a future date, but we're at very early stages. I really want to look at it. The work of this committee will be really helpful in that, and the work and the understanding from the sector will be really helpful in that. But it may become a time in the future where we look at a regular uprating and having that placed in legislation.
I appreciate it is at an early stage, but has the Minister and has Government considered how that would work in practice? Would it be linked to an inflationary index or some other index? And would we see an implementation period like we're seeing this year between the uprating being brought in or announced and the change on the shelves to reflect the call from industry and businesses that they need that time to make changes?
Yeah, I'll be absolutely honest, I'm open-minded on the ways in which we can do this. We're looking at many ways in which we can tackle this, and every official in the department have got different experience, so they're coming with all of that information as well. So whether inflation is the measure, and then we'll have an argument about whether it's CPI or RPI, so we can work that out. But my mind's opened, and you're absolutely right about giving a business that opportunity to be ready, so that's why we listen to their calls. And if this goes through, this one, 65 pence, it will be September before that, and that's to be implemented, and that's what they thought they needed. Some were looking for 12 months, which was stretching it a wee bit, but we think 6 months is a good enough time. And if it's something that becomes, you know, almost a regular thing, then the opportunity will be there to do that. You'll know the First Minister set a new deal with business, and that's why just last week I met with the business partner, the alcohol business partnership group, to talk about some of the concerns and the challenges that they've got. So again, trying to take as much as a balanced view on this as possible, and make life, I'm not here to make life more difficult for our producers. We've got a world leading food and drinks industry that's the global impact is huge. I wouldn't want to diminish any of that, but we do have to get the balance right.
And on the uprating as well, obviously there may be times where inflation is much higher, like we've seen in recent times, and the impact will obviously differ on minimum unit pricing depending on that economic outlook. But I'm also quite interested in how we put that lived and living experience that has been so important the whole way through at the heart of any uprating and analysis that we do, so that if there is ever a case, and obviously we're speaking in hypotheticals here, but if there is ever a case where that uprating does have to be higher for good reason, that experience that has been so integral and useful so far is put at the heart of what we do.
Yeah, I'm a policy person who doesn't make policy without the people being impacted by the policy sitting at the table, and that's the approach that I've taken in all of my ministerial and parliamentary roles. I think even in my past professional life, I didn't make any policy decisions without people sitting at the table. So that lived and living experience is absolutely key. I think my answer to your first question about being open-minded is exactly the answer to your question about the process of uprating, because inflation may be a crude measure of a way to do it, given some of the economic impacts we had, sharp inflation rise and then drop in inflation. That may not be the measure that we will use. And as I say, my mind is opened. And if colleagues in the committee have got ideas on how we can maybe do that, then please let me know. I'm very keen to work with both Parliament, across government, and with stakeholders to make sure we get that right.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I do have a question about uprating, but I'd like to just go back to harmful drinkers. So the policy memorandum for the original bill, if you remember, emphasised that minimum pricing would reduce the consumption of alcohol by harmful drinkers. But instead, we've actually, if you look at the facts, we've seen a 25% increase in alcohol-related deaths over the past 3 years alone, and over the past 10 years, the number of people accessing alcohol treatment services has actually gone down by 40%. So do you agree that harmful and hazardous drinkers are the ones who need the greatest help?
That's a yes. It's straight off. It's obviously a yes. Public Health Scotland evaluation found that the evidence points to minimum unit pricing having a positive impact on health outcomes for harmful and hazardous drinking. And the work that we have done around that is incredibly detailed. So my answer is yes, that those people do need the most support. And I think that point that you made about a 40% drop and people accessing services is something that's confounded us, and we're doing a bit of work to understand why that is. And this is anecdotal, but from some of the conversation I've been having across the board, there's particular groups of people who, because of stigma, will not go and access services. Women are pretty big in that category as well, so that's why my work looking at the impact on women of minimum unit pricing and the support that they need, and that's why the work that Professor Alan Miller's doing around about stigma. And the work that lots of the organisations are doing around about stigma. And because I've got a real concern that if we make, like we do with people who have got a drug dependency, and alcohol dependency is basically, they're shunned socially, then the opportunities for them to come forward for treatment are much more difficult. So because we are taking such a public health approach to this, we are hoping we're creating the circumstances where people feel confident about coming for treatment. But we are a bit confounded by that 40% drop, and we are doing detailed work in analysing that and understanding how we can pivot services to do that. And Orlando's been really involved in this work, so he can come in and give you more detail.
Earlier you said it's going to impact all drinkers, and particularly those people who it's going to hit in their shopping basket, who are social drinkers. So rather than MUP targeting harmful drinkers, it's going to hit everybody in the social drinkers.
So it's really difficult because of the cost of living crisis whether that's actually completely accurate, because some of the biggest impacts for people right now is the cost of living crisis and the impact that's had on them for their shopping, for their energy bills and for everything else in their life too. So there's it's a bit more nuanced than just, you know, that one approach. There's other things that have influence in some of those issues that people are facing, and the cost of living crisis is a huge influence
in
that.
And you do recognise there are massively differing opinions on this. Many people just think, rather than a silver bullet, it's a blunt instrument with massive holes in it.
So, and others would argue the complete opposite. Even in the consultation, ideas and understanding were pretty polarised, even in the consultation. So I would take the Public Health Scotland, Sheffield University, frontline workers, public health directors. I'm afraid I will take their expertise much more to heart in the work that I need to do to make a difference here than maybe some of the people who would be sitting in the sidelines criticising the policy but have no real ideas on how to do it themselves. And I must reiterate again, I do not believe this is a silver bullet. There is no one who's saying this is a silver bullet. It's not. It's only one of the tools we have in the box in order to tackle the issues that we face.
We'll ask a question about a rating, but Public Health Scotland's data was based on modelling, and we did sort of focus, and they actually agreed that it was based on modelling rather than actual stats.
Catherine. Yep. Public Health Scotland conducted a number of studies where they estimated the impact of what would have happened compared to if minimum unit pricing was not in place.
So you can modelling, not stats. I will actually go back to the uprating question. So, Minister, you talk about whether it's RPI or CPI in the future. Is it your intention to come back to Parliament when there's a review and for a robust analysis based on facts, not modelling? Thank you.
So I think we have to take all analysis into account, and I think modelling is a recommended, respected way in which to tackle societal issues and getting the information that we need to move a policy forward. So I wouldn't underestimate the impact of modelling and the work that's done at Sheffield University and Public Health Scotland. But I take your point about, you know, data and facts, because that's one of the issues that we all face in having that information as well. As far as coming back to Parliament, as I said to Gillian Mackay, my mind is completely open on a process of uprating. We are working across some of that information right now in the best way to do that. I will bring it back to this committee if that's what you wish. I'm happy to come to Parliament and do that in Parliament. But I suspect in order to do that, there will be another change to legislation, so that we'll have to go through the process anyway.
Check. So you're open-minded to come back to this committee, hopefully when you've got some facts rather than models, and that would be a good opportunity to come and have another review and discuss it and debate it.
I'm happy to come back when I've considered all of the evidence, including facts and modelling.
Thank you. Ivan McKee.
Thank you. I've got some specific questions, but I just wanted to maybe just round back on a couple of things. I mean, just to help me understand, or just for the record, on this facts versus modelling thing, my understanding is that the analysis that's been done is based on facts and statistics, but it's addressing a counterfactual because there's other variables in the mix. So to say that it isn't based on facts is incorrect. Is that a correct analysis?
Yes. I mean, if we were to look at the statistics, the data that we have on alcohol-specific deaths and hospital admissions, they are impacted by a huge number of different factors across society. We've already spoken about COVID and the cost of living crisis. They're two things that have happened in the same time period that MUP has been implemented. So what Public Health Scotland needed to do was find a way of disentangling all of that, of getting down to the impact of minimum unit pricing. And they did that by comparing Scotland with a counterfactual. So they compared Scotland with England, which had experienced similar, you know, has a similar culture, similar economy, and has also been through the pandemic and a cost of living crisis, and looked at the differences there, and that is how they got to the conclusions that minimum unit pricing had led to a decrease in alcohol-specific deaths and likely to have led to a decrease in hospitalisations. That also is put together with all the other work that Public Health Scotland did. The evaluation was a huge portfolio of studies looking at different aspects along a theory of change. So it looked at compliance with minimum unit pricing, it looked at what happened to the price of alcohol, it looked at consumption, and then because all the things along that theory of change were met, you know, there was compliance with minimum unit pricing, the price of alcohol increased and consumption decreased, therefore that helped increase the confidence around this decrease in alcohol-specific deaths and hospitalisations being due to the impact of MUP.
Thank you. So it is based on facts, and they've used some robust statistical analysis to isolate the different variables as best they could.
Yeah. Thanks very much. That's recognised in the letter to the Lancet from Professor Michael Marmon and Sally Caswell, and they said this summary of research on minimum unit pricing is comprehensive, including interviews with individuals who fear the policy will be detrimental to them personally or financially. Public Health Scotland approach to emphasising population level findings is the right one for assessing population level interventions such as minimum unit pricing. So they were absolutely clear about the value of that analysis. Okay,
thanks very much. So second point I want just to touch on, just to clarify something for me, maybe I missed this, but just to be clear, if we're talking about uprating, then clearly the options you've got are to come back in a similar process to what we've done today in a year or two or three and talk about the next hike, or it could be to put in place a process that automatically uprates. To automatically uprate, would that require primary legislation, or what would need to be done from a legislative point of view to prevent you having to come back every year or two to go back through this process again?
Yeah, I think for us, as we explore it, we'd need to look at what the right approach was. Clearly, if it's automatic, we'd kind of take legal advice on that. There's obviously the opportunity to uprate it using regulations, as we've done here. So I think what we'd be keen to do is continue kind of exploring with a wide range of people what the right approach is, what the right measure is, and the committee, obviously, and come back with a clear plan.
By the process, so if you decided that you're going to put up by, let's say, RPI or CPI every year, to make it give that effect, that would require primary legislation change, is that correct, which would be an amendment to the the Act, is that correct?
I mean, you could amend the regulations, so there's a kind of range of things you could potentially do. If you see, I mean, because the operating process of changes now allows us to lay an order.
So that would also be an automatic process?
So it depends what you mean by automated, I suppose.
But automating means you don't have to come back here every year and argue for another five to ten pence.
Yeah.
It just happens.
We'd certainly need to take legal advice on that as we move forward. But at the moment, there's kind of a wide range of options on what that looks like. So.
We'll look for the best option, I think, that allows Parliament to scrutinise any decisions that are being made, but also to ensure that we can continue with the benefits of this policy.
Yeah, I mean, just to be clear, because, of course, we talk about increasing it, but the reality is we're just standing still. The decision not to increase it is, in effect, in real money, a decision to reduce it. It's important to recognise that. Okay.
Yeah, and that's why that modelling found that 60-62% was maybe 60-62 pence was where it would just bring it up to the level inflation added from 50 pence, and that's why we decided 65, because it takes it to that one threshold further. We did look at modelling on 70 and other prices per unit, but we felt that 65 gave us the right balance between impact on industry and impact on public health.
That's great, thanks. And of course, that will be based on 2018, not in 2012, when the 50 pence was first proposed.
Yes, I think so. Yes.
Yes, which was much higher inflation over that period, cumulatively, of course. So thanks very much. Moving on, I wanted to unpick a wee bit. Well, first, a brief point on time to prepare for businesses. If I'm correct, it's not an exact analogy, but when the Chancellor puts up alcohol duty, that happens almost immediately. Is that correct? Whereas in this case, you're given quite a lengthy period of time for businesses to prepare. Is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Right, OK. So if you compare those two, then the fact you're given quite a significant period already to businesses in that regard. I wanted to focus primarily on some of the points that Paul Sweeney had raised. And first of all, just to recognise that the public health supplement, as was, obviously was done prior to MUP, so it's important to maybe separate out those two things as not being dependent on each other, but potentially related to each other. And I would just like to, with regards to the NUP issue and this thing that's been kind of dancing around us through the evidence sessions that we're struggling to get our arms around about whether or not there actually has been an increase in revenue to retailers or producers as a consequence of MUP. Certainly the evidence we took from the cider producers, a 300% or there or thereabouts increase in the retail price of their product, but an 80% reduction in volume of sales, would suggest that they've seen perhaps a 20% reduction, an increase or reduction in retail revenues because the reduction in volume sold has outweighed the increase in any price. I suppose the question is, do you have any data on this other than what we've managed to piece together through some of that kind of ad hoc evidence session? I would expect HMRC has got some pretty robust data on that, even if the industry is unable to provide us with any data. So is this something you've got something on so as we can kind of put this thing to bed once and for all?
I mean, at the moment, there's not clear data across the piece on this. There's a range of a kind of anecdotal information. We can certainly follow up with HMRC, but I'm not aware there'll be a kind of clear link on volume versus kind of pricing sales. So we've got a lot of information. However, it's something we're keen to kind of continue working on to look at the differential spread of some of that. Because we know, for instance, that producers maybe are providing a different view as to retailers where the revenue is being held across the supply chain. So.
Okay. There's differences for different retailers. So if it's the off trade and it's a bottle shop, they can pretty clearly see the difference there. If it's supermarket sales, that's become really difficult to separate out and between people buying whatever they buy with a shopping. So that's been a bit more difficult for supermarkets to separate that out. But HMRC might have some of that data, so we'll follow that one up.
Yeah, having worked in the sector, I know that HMRC keeps a very close look, watch on how much alcohol people are selling.
They'll know from alcohol duty.
Yeah, absolutely, on different types of products. Yeah. OK, now that might be, but if you get anything, that'd be helpful, just to help put this and I don't know if you've got any other data on...
We have access to sales data in a general sense, but it doesn't provide us revenue, right? So it gives you volume of sales, it doesn't give you the kind of cost of those sales. So I think we use those, it's certainly useful. That's certainly useful on how we look at alcohol purchase rates in Scotland across the piece. And PHS will continue to do that as part of their kind of work around, you know, alcohol harm and alcohol-related statistics.
Yeah, because my concern on this is that we're all kind of chasing this golden pot of money, but in reality it possibly doesn't exist. It'd be nice to put that to bed once and for all. Moving on then to talk about the public health supplement. And I think you've already indicated that you're having a look at that potentially. So I don't know if there's any more you can say on what you might do on that, when you might come back with a perspective on that and who it might impact, because clearly I think it was larger retailers before, or supermarkets are impacted.
Yeah, it was, and as you say, it was before MUP. The DFM and, you know, stated the intention in her statement just recently that we would relook at this. So we are at very, very early stages. We've had calls from stakeholder organisations like SHAP and others, and Alcohol Focus Scotland, asking us to have a look at this again, from the perspective of, if you raise the levy, can it be spent, ring-fenced and spent in those areas, which is, you know, perfectly reasonable ask. However, we need to balance that with the impact on business, in which you have just illustrated very clearly about, you know, how do we measure that, and how do we ensure that we direct any additional monies to the places where they need to go. So that's why I said to Gillian McCann, very open-minded on this.
Okay.
If your experience in the industry has got anything to tell us, please share that. I'm really keen to work across Parliament and Government to get that right. And it might be getting it right is not to have a levy. You know, and maybe getting it right might be a levy. And I think for Alcohol Focus Scotland and others there, you know, they were suggesting around about 16 pence, you know. So they've got some ideas already, and we'll interrogate all of those and factor them into our thinking about how we move forward with that particular point.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Kavira.
I appreciate, Minister, we've already gone over time, but I believe Sandesh Gohani has a question. So if we could have a brief question and a short answer, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Minister, coming back to modelling, we are clear that when we did our modelling, it is an estimate of the number of people that MUP has saved. So if we look at the difference of age-standardised alcohol-specific deaths per 100,000 people, England versus Scotland, in 2006-07, actually the difference meant that Scotland did better than England. 2008-09, difference was better in Scotland. In 2011-12, it was better in Scotland. So the Scotland had reduced alcohol-specific deaths compared to England. There was no MUP then. And then if we look when MUP was brought in 2018-19, there was, again, a difference. Not as good as 2006-07, but it was there was a reduction. But then 1920, actually, England did better than Scotland, and 2021 was the same. Can you explain that to me?
So that timeline that you've given us is over 17, 18 years, a lot of time, a lot of interventions, a lot of work being done to reduce drug-related alcohol deaths and hospital admissions. I think that we took the decision to continue and to implement minimum unit pricing because we saw the benefit, not just in the short term, but in the long term. And that's why my commitment is to continue this policy and to uprate it, because I think we can see the definite change that's happening there. Is it long enough to understand that on a population level? Probably not. And that's why the reviews and the work that's been done and the modelling that's been done becomes incredibly important in all of that. And then, yes, it is estimates. It can only be estimates because, again, disentangling, the outcomes for people and health outcomes, particularly for people who they don't factor into the death statistics, they factor into the reduction in hazardous and harm, is a bit more difficult to understand. And that's why that modelling is done in the way that it's done, and the analysis is done in the way that it's done, but also to help us understand how we move forward with this. And we want to uprate precisely for that reason, that differential has narrowed, and we want to make sure that differential increases again. And if you look at what the Director of Public Health in North East England are saying, they are saying this policy works. We can see that it works. We've made the comparison between Scotland and North East of England. And I think their assumption, no, their assumption, the recommendation is that they want minimum unit pricing for England and Wales. And I think that's a really important point there.
Thank you, Minister. And just, you know, you said that it's not in the short term. I'm being very cheeky asking another question, but would you commit to maybe doing another review in 5 years' time to see what's happened?
So we're going to keep this under continuous review. Whether in 5 years' time we do a full review will be for probably other people to decide. But my commitment is to keep this under continuous review to ensure that we're able to be fleet of foot given some of the changes. We may see some of the impacts of the pandemic then playing out over the next couple of years and how we can respond to that as well. But I think our policy like this would always benefit from being reviewed. And no doubt there'll be academics and others out there who will continuously review it anyway. But I think this government has a commitment to reviewing all of this work, and we will continue to do that.
I just had one point from Mr. Glandis on an earlier point that the Scottish Government's court submission described hazardous and harmful drinkers. So when the court was talking about problematic drinkers, it was referring to, you know, the submission that we provided. So I think it was taken in that context. I just thought it'd be helpful to note that kind of factual correction for the committee.
Thank you. We will now move on to agenda item 3, which is the formal debate on the instruments in which we've just taken evidence. Can I remind the committee that officials may not speak in the debate? Minister, can I ask you to move and speak to motions S6M 12220 and S6M 12221, lodged by yourself?
Thanks very much, Convener, and I'm happy to lodge both those amendments. And I think there's not much more to say, really, in our position, other than, you know, my key opening remarks about we believe that now is the time, following the review, to both continue this policy and to uprate it to 65p. And I commend both those regulations to the committee and would hope you would support them.
Thank you, Minister. I've had an indication from one member of the committee so far that they wish to speak. Carol Malkin.
Thank you, Convener. In relation to today's SSIs, I can confirm that Scottish Labour does support the continuation of MUP and the uprating of the MUP to 65 pence. We support the work undertaken by Public Health Scotland on this, and the data produced is complicated, as we've heard, but we believe is clear. MUP worked for so long as 50 pence was an effective price and lives were saved as a result. And this is undoubtedly significant, and it is only right that we continue the policy and look further at the impacts it has on public health with an uprated price. MUP, however, is not and will never be effective on its own, and I welcome the Minister's acknowledgement of this point. In relation to dependent drinkers, and we have discussed this morning, Public Health Scotland concluded there is limited, it's just a quote, there is limited evidence to suggest that MUP was effective in reducing consumption for those people with alcohol dependency. Those with alcohol dependency are a particular subgroup of those who drink at harmful levels and have specific needs. People with alcohol dependency need timely and evidence-based treatment and wider support that addresses the root causes of the dependency. And Scottish Labour, you know, supports this statement. The long-term underfunding of alcohol and drug partnerships, the cutbacks to health services and council budgets, and the real-term cuts to investment in this year's budget suggest that the government could become over-reliant on MUP as a unitary method of tackling alcohol harm. This will not work, experts tell us as such, and the government, I hope, will now move to outline that further commitment they will make to these services which offer support within our communities. Just one more point further to this. We believe we cannot continue MUP for much longer without ensuring that the profit it creates for larger companies is reinvested in publicly funded public health initiatives. And we feel that this is only right, and we would seek to work with colleagues to achieve this. In concluding, Convener, the continuation of MUP is, in my view, a positive step. Its continuation has Scottish Labour's support, But once again, I would urge colleagues to ensure work is undertaken by government to properly fund and support services that will save the lives and commit to vital services in areas of those living in our highest levels of deprivation. If we do not do this and act with purpose, we will quickly see the benefits of MUP fade. And this is not something any of us want. And I know from today's debate, this is the position of the Minister, and I hope to work with the Minister to put these things together. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Carol. Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. MUP is a blunt instrument to tackle a very complex problem, and the Public Health Scotland evaluation is riddled with holes, and that alcohol-specific deaths are at their highest since 2008. Moderate drinkers are being penalised and will be penalised even further by the price increase, and other approaches to treat alcohol addiction are underfunded and under-resourced. Thank you.
Thank you. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to start my remarks by looking at Public Health Scotland's report, in which civil servants decided to intervene and change wording. So, for example, wording was supposed to be consistent, and civil servants went and decided to write strong and consistent, and that was the wording that appeared not in the draft, but now in the final report from Public Health Scotland. We can see that Tess White said earlier during committee there's been a 40% reduction in alcohol treatment that's occurred. And whilst the Minister has spoken many times saying that this is not the silver bullet and it's nuanced and there's lots of other things that need to be done, the facts are nothing else is being done. This is the government's silver bullet. This is the only thing that they seem to be doing when it comes to the area of alcohol. And we simply need to see more treatment occurring, because that has proven to reduce people's dependence on alcohol. It's also proven to reduce deaths and improve lives and save lives. We need to also look upon the fact that a policy which increases the price of alcohol will affect dependent drinkers disproportionately. The whole point of being a dependent drinker is you drink to the exclusion of other things. That is your primary focus. You are dependent upon that substance. And a policy which has increased the price, knowing, and the government must have known, it would affect dependent drinkers, and yet nothing was done for dependent drinkers over the time of MUP to help them, to ensure that they didn't spend more money on alcohol, to ensure that they actually came away from alcohol. That, to me, is absolutely awful, because we should have known. The government should have known. The 25 civil servants working on this policy should have known that that would happen. I'd like to speak about profit and the outrageous profits that are being made because of MUP by retailers. It's simply unacceptable that a policy designed to help people is creating huge amounts of money, and that money is not being reinvested into alcohol programmes, into helping the people that it was designed to be helping. In court, it's clear that this is not supposed to be a population-level approach. That was not what the government said in court, and yet the minister said to me that it was the point of this. So that doesn't make sense to me either. And when we talk about other evidence, a Taiwanese group wrote in The Lancet that the modelling that has been done was simply not accurate, and this is not doing what we think it's doing. The facts are, we have increased by 25% the number of people who have died because of alcohol. That is the numbers. And saying that we have saved 156 lives in modelling suggests that had we not had MUP, we would have had the highest number of deaths ever. We've also heard from the Minister that we have confounders when it comes to this, which are the biggest confounder here is simply the cost of living, but also COVID. We must see with a full evaluation what happens in 5 years' time when hopefully we don't have these confounders in place, and that would be able to give us a really good indication of what's going on. And the Minister has said that we're looking to have a reduction, an increase in the amount of money spent on people who are treated for drug and alcohol, and I welcome that. And so I would ask the Minister to back our Right to Recovery Bill, which would give people the right to have this treatment, thus forcing our health and social care partnerships to invest in this level. So in summary, what I would say is this evaluation has not proved that MUP is what we set it out to be, which was to help those of the heaviest drinkers in our society. And we need to ensure that if it does go ahead, that we use the money that's been generated to help those people. Otherwise, I think it's an absolute travesty. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Convener. I've written some notes here based on what we've received in evidence, but also just to reiterate what the intention of the minimum unit pricing policy is. And I just want to restate some of the content from the correspondence that the committee received from the Association of Directors of Public Health North East on the 20th of March. And they said, as partners based in the North East of England, which is a region that suffers from the worst alcohol harms in England, the public health directors in the North East have said that they have watched the positive impact of MUP in Scotland with huge interest. And they actually used the word admiration. And at the time when alcohol deaths in England, and especially in the North East, are at an all-time high, ADPH North East are asking for similarly proactive and enlightened public health policies to reduce alcohol harm and protect the most vulnerable in our communities. And the directors of Public Health North East are hugely supportive of the Scottish Minister's proposal to continue to uprate MUP and agree with the level of at least 65 pence per unit. And according to the ADPH North East, the evidence is clear that the policy has achieved its aim of reducing alcohol-related harm by both reducing population consumption and by targeting the consumption of people drinking at higher levels. It has also contributed to reducing alcohol-related health inequalities. And again, this is what North East public health directors are saying, and I quote, they're saying the evidence from Scotland is clear. MUP works by targeting the cheapest, most harmful alcohol, and we hope that the Scottish Government will see fit to continue and uprate the MUP as part of its enlightened evidence-based approach to public health. And additionally, we received a letter signed by over 80 organisations, medical faith organisations and charities, calling for cross-party support to continue MUP. And you know, in flicking through some of their data, they're saying there's an estimated 156 families each year who have been spared the loss of a loved one, and that alcohol can have a serious impact at every stage of life, with the impact in pregnancy having a lifelong effect on the child. And hospital admissions are down by an estimated 4.1%, reducing the pressure on our NHS. So in the final sentence from that submission, and I've tweaked it a wee bit because I agree, now that MUP has been seen to work, the 80 organisations and myself support the continuation of this policy and to uprate MUP to save more lives. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. We've heard at this committee recently of the impact of MUP from lived and living experience, and this for me has added real-world context to the evaluation we've seen, something which we welcome in many other areas of this committee's work. Those voices need to be amplified and continue to be involved in this issue, and I'm pleased that the Minister has indicated her willingness to continue to put this at the heart of policy development going forward. We need to ensure that going forward there is appropriate support and treatment mix for those who require it, and that we tackle barriers for those groups who are currently having difficulties in accessing treatment. I accept and trust the Minister's assertion that this is not a silver bullet, and one of the most important things we need to do is tackle the alcohol environment we have here in Scotland. And for me, this includes looking at advertising, how this advertising affects children and young people and at-risk adult drinkers, as well as implementing a public health levy, which I'm really pleased was in the budget as a result of discussions between government and my party. Tackling alcohol harm has to be a multi-pronged approach and tackle all the barriers that people are facing to services. And I'm very pleased to be supporting both SSIs this morning.
Thank you, Gillian Mackay. Minister, would you like to sum up and respond to the debate?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. That's really helpful. Can I start with thanking both Labour, the SNP members and the Green members for the support to the policy, the comments that you have all made about work still to be done and the way in which we fund the sector and the analysis and the work we have to do around about looking at a health levy is not lost on me, so I will be taking all of them away as actions. Can I reassure members on funding? This is a record £112 million that I will, I'm absolutely committed to making sure that it gets spent in exactly the right places, so I can give that reassurance. Can I also pick up some of the points around about who supports this policy? So that's in response to Tess White and Sandesh Gohani. We have seen the Lancet letter. We have seen the Association of Public Health Directors in North East England, and Emma Harper's obviously made reference to that work. We've seen 80 organisations who work with people on the ground, day in, day out, supporting them. We've seen case studies like the work Simon Communities doing, and we've seen those modelling numbers given us 156 people whose lives have been saved. That's not an insignificant number. That's 156 loved ones, and we should never forget that that's people in those numbers and not just numbers. And if I can pick up the point on treatment. So on treatment, the 40% drop that we have experienced here has also been experienced in England, and they're also looking at the reasons for that. But it's just not true to say that nothing else has been done on this matter. And I'll give you a list of things that we are currently taking forward to tackle all of the issues, whether it's harmful, hazardous or dependent drinkers. So we're working on new clinical guidelines on alcohol treatment, and we're working with the UK government on that, actually, so that we've got that whole UK approach. Alcohol brief intervention review, national specifications on alcohol and drugs. All ADPs already offer psychological counselling, inpatient alcohol detox services, access to medication, and most offer community detox, ABIs, alcohol hospital liaison. So it's just not true to say that nothing is being done, because all of that is already being done. And as for the Right to Recovery bill, I've been asking for months to have a view of this, details of it. We have not received that at all. And even just last week I responded, which I generally don't do on government business, on social media to a colleague of us, Annie Wells, who was saying, will you support the Right to Recovery Bill? And I said, I'm happy to meet with you and discuss it. And we have got that date in the diary now. So I'm happy to discuss this bill, but we need to see the detail to understand what it will actually do. I'm glad to see that lots of people support the levy. I think maybe some of your colleagues might be a bit disgruntled that you're saying you support looking at the levy, because many of them don't, Mr. Gohani, so keen to work with you on all of that. And I have to say, most of those organisations, or all of those organisations who have written to us, agree that minimum unit pricing works. They also agree it's not the silver bullet. It has achieved its aim, and Gillian Mackay is absolutely right. At the heart of this is those people whose lives will be made immeasurably better. And that's why that lived and living experience is at the heart of all of the work that I will do. So I would ask the committee today to support the Alcohol Minimum Price in Scotland Act 2012 Continuation Order 2024, and to support the Alcohol Minimum Price Per Unit Scotland Amendment Order 2024, which seeks to change the level from 50 pence per unit to 65 pence per unit. And I thank the committee for all of the deliberations. None of it is lost on me. All of it will be used to inform my work going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that motion S6M12220 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The committee is not in agreement, and so we will call a division. inviting members to indicate by a show of hands for, against or abstentions. So those in favour of approving the motion, please raise your hand. Those against? And there are no abstentions. So the result of the vote on this motion 12220 is 8 votes in favour, 2 votes against, no abstentions, and the motion is approved. The question is that motion S6M 12221 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The committee is not agreed, therefore we will have another vote. Can I ask again, members raise their hands if you are in favour of the motion. Those against? And there are no abstentions. Everyone's voted. And the result of the vote on motion 12221 is 8 for, 2 against, no abstentions, and the motion is approved. And that concludes consideration of these instruments. The next item on our agenda is consideration of one negative instrument, the Regulation of Care Social Service Workers Scotland Order 2024. The purpose of the instrument is with respect to the registration of social service workers to reduce the number of register parts from 23 to 4 by creating only 2 categories of social service worker rather than 21. The policy note states that the objective of the instrument is to make registration and being registered straightforward and easy to understand. The current register structure has been developed over time since the introduction of registration of social workers in 2003, and it's stated that the structure of the register needs to change to reflect changing and emerging roles as well as changes in the way services are delivered. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 5th of March 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do members have any comments? I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree? No one disagrees, thank you, and I confirm agreement with my proposal. At our next meeting on the 16th of April, we'll be considering a negative instrument and a draft stage one report on the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.